thank you.
Thank you.
Introduce our speaker for the day. Today we got a great speaker. Just get her bio here. She's from the Partnership for Strong Communities, Kate Schaefer. She's been recently promoted to the role of Deputy Policy Director for the Partnership, and what she's going to be doing is managing the Home Connecticut campaign, which is charting solutions to Connecticut's shortage of housing affordable, housing that's affordable to workers, young professionals, families, and others. Katie's also coordinating education and advocacy efforts that relate housing to school achievement, transportation, energy, healthcare, and other key disciplines. One of the reasons I invited her to speak with us today because we had David Fink come to our council meeting a few months ago, talking about housing choices that municipalities can make that are beyond what they think is affordable. And I asked David Fink to attend. He is since semi-retired, and our lovely Katie Schaefer is coming and speaking on that topic today. So thank you, Katie.
Thank you. So much background.
So, I'm going to circulate some handouts. Just take one. Everything is available on our website. We talk about everything in depth.
Thank you.
So you can sort of consider some takeaways. And each town housing data profile, which is the staple document, is in that packet, so you can find your town there. Organization. Can you hear? So we work very closely with municipal leaders, policymakers, and communities to advance affordable housing options across the state. We work very closely with the administration and the legislature. We're not state contractors. And really, you know, I see towns as sort of, you know, our key constituents because you're really on the ground facing the challenges day in and day out. So the main thrust of what we're here for today, I wanted to present to you, like Joanna said, our housing data profiles. We develop these every 2 years, so hot off the press. They give you a really great snapshot of what's going on in your community's housing market. On the back are all the sources of all the data. There's a short narrative on the second to last page with some key facts. There's a lot of data inside of this, and we try to make it to make the most sense for you as possible and as user-friendly as possible. We do this so you don't need to spend the money to do this, because it's an intensive process to go through all the ACS data. We have this for every city, we have it for every county, we have it statewide, it's all available on our website. So what I thought is I'd give you what we're seeing at the state and county levels, and then I also want to take an opportunity to dive a little bit deeper into what's going on in your COG. You know, usually my song and dance is to other different constituents. Your COG is unique in terms of having diversity inside of its housing stock, the age of its housing stock, it's really unique. So sort of my usual, well, most of the housing was developed after the 70s, it's all for the boomers, it's predominantly single family, you don't really have smaller units, you don't have a lot of affordable housing, your parents are in the tank, therefore do X, Y, and Z, and it's really simple. But your COG is different, and it's really exciting to us, so I wanted to dig in deeper and invite some conversation considering the resources that have been committed, the transit options that are coming online, the coordinated state investment that's coming online, and how that can help unlock some assets and what we can do at the partnership to help you with that. So the fact is that there are a variety of economic and demographic factors that the housing market today is just so vastly different from what it was a generation ago. And that means that it's stock, so it's balanced between homeownership and rental. Single family versus multifamily is out of step, it's out of sync with what the demand is. And considering the nature of those demographics, those trends are likely here to stay, right? We're just seeing the beginning of the baby boomers retiring, so we're seeing the millennials, you know, starting to enter the housing market now. So these trends are not not in passing. As we've seen from the Warren Group data on housing price sales, that through 2/3 of this year, actually 23 of the last 25 months have seen prices flat or declining. Even though sales volume is going up, the prices have not followed step. But at the same time, we know that multifamily housing is meeting the demand. So nationwide, the housing demand for multifamily is the highest it's been in 28 years. That's what the U.S. Department of Commerce reported this summer. So the question is kind of what's going on here? Why is that demand so high? And the answer is when we look at who's demanding, who's driving the housing demand right now. So we have the baby boomers, 55 to 64, who want to downsize. We know that 1 in 3 don't have a year's worth of savings in the bank, that they do not want the four-bedroom colonial, that they need to sell their homes in order to downsize because their equity is tied up in their homes. We're hearing from young professionals. Sometimes I think millennials get a bad rap for various reasons, but as the like entitled generation, I'm just out of that, so I can have an opinion too. But we know that they're burdened by college debt. Connecticut's sixth in the nation for education debt. I mean, it's high across the country. It's gone up by tens of thousands of dollars in the last 15 years, and it's obviously much higher when you go to private universities. So the idea of coming out of school and being able to save for a down payment quickly is just not realistic when you have to have that debt. And we continue to hear from working families who are struggling under burdens of housing costs and the contortions of you know, an evolving work schedule different from generations ago and a lack of access to transportation. We know that half of renters are spending more than 30% of their income on housing. And when they do that, that means they're hovering very close to housing instability. It means that they can't patronize shops and downtown restaurants, and they certainly can't save for a down payment when they're paying, they're paying an effective mortgage and their rent. So these are populations that we know demographically are demanding smaller housing, walkable to services, transit, and downtown shopping. They need it to be affordable, and that the market just isn't providing that. So a little bit of background on what's going on in the Connecticut housing landscape. Most of Connecticut's towns, other than Lower Fairfield County, developed from 1970 on. And as I mentioned earlier, that was for the then boomer population that was just growing their families. So that's led to a real skew towards single family housing. Many towns, two-thirds of their towns, developed more than 40% of their housing stock after 1970, and that's why it's predominantly single-family. So you can take a look at this, actually, to tell you a little bit more about that. So the question is, how has that single-family housing stock stood the test of time? What we did is we looked at the Grandland data for the most recent available time frame, which was 08 to 13. And we saw that the real property grand list dropped in 151 municipalities. So that means that they're not able to keep up with annual service costs. And we know from CCM that means that towns need to evaluate whether they need to raise the mill rate or decrease services. So it's really important that those grand lists continue to grow. And if we're depending on single family housing to do that, which is the stuff that dominates most of these towns, that's a big problem. You can see that the boomers need to sell their homes to downsize. The grand lists need to grow, which means the prices need to go up. So the question is, where are the buyers, right? So most folks rented at one point in their life. I think the statistic that I don't have a source for, so I don't quote it publicly, but I'm going to hear is that 90% of people rented, and that's how they were able to save for a down payment. I know that's what happened in my family. So we needed a way of access to get into town, in addition for a way for seniors to remain in town and stay connected to their communities. So in these towns that don't have any multifamily to speak of, there is no access point into town. I know that, so I'm not from Connecticut, right? So when I moved to town, I wanted to be close to where I worked. I rented, I didn't know where I wanted to buy. I was single at the time, and got married and wanted to start a family and wanted to buy. Where did we buy? We bought in the town where we rented, and I think that's something that a lot of people can relate to. But we know that Connecticut has the most expensive housing markets in the country. It's the sixth most expensive housing market nationwide. It has the eighth most expensive rental market. You would need to make $24.29 an hour to afford a typical two-bedroom rent. And just to give you a sense of perspective, half of the jobs in Connecticut pay less than $20 an hour, so $40,000 a year full-time. So you can take a look at this income and jobs worksheet. So we broke this down by different, what we call area median incomes, which is an industry standard way to look at the different populations and what they're earning. The guide is that you should not be spending more than 30% of your income on housing. And the fact is that housing costs have escalated and jobs and employment have not, wages have not kept up with that. And we find that when we speak with municipal leadership and commission members that they just don't really know what people are making these days. And I think we're all guilty of that. So we know that the demand for multifamily housing is going to continue. So the question is, what can the town do? Town zoning commission members didn't sign on to be proactive redevelopment officers, but we know that towns that are really making strides have taken a very transition. So there are some state programs, namely the Incentive Housing Zone Program, that is a grant program for towns, which are looking at what their housing stock is, where multifamily should be, what the right mix is programmatically and in terms of affordability. There are more state resources committed to housing in the last 5 years than in the last 30 years. And I apologize that I didn't give you background, but by the way, my background, I'm an attorney and I was an affordable housing developer in the state. So I know how fun it can be to work with state money, but you know, hopefully I gave you some insight when I tell you that there is a much more streamlined process with the Department of Housing, which we didn't have 5 years ago, and there is much more fluid funding that is much more easily accessible and much more streamlined and doesn't require 6-inch binders anymore. Unless you wanted to, which you can. So what I thought I would do is I wanted to just facilitate a little bit more conversation since yours is a really large cause. So what I did is if you take a look at it, this is my cheat sheet. It's a compilation of census data and the latest data from the Warren Group, what's going on. So like I said, you know, very frequently I look at a town snapshot, a housing data profile, and it's 92% single family housing with, you know, just a small smattering of housing that has smaller bedroom sizes. And like I said, they have a small number of affordable housing units, their real property grant lists are decreasing, so therefore they should just be developing more multifamily. But like I said, your region is a little bit more complex. Oh, and I didn't touch on the projections of population. We do know that we're entering the silver tsunami, that the 65 and over generation, that population is going to grow. But I also want to highlight that the projections for school age population are pretty startling. Most towns are looking at a significant decrease in their children aged 5 to 19, and that's pretty startling because that's your next generation of your town.
What's driving that?
Well, it's a compilation of things, but trending towards smaller families, which is a nationwide trend that we're seeing, right? Families are now fewer than 3 children per family. Need a small family unit. Also, there are just fewer housing options for younger professionals to come into town, put down roots, and start a family there, too. I also put that data up there, and that's from the State Data Center. We can talk a little bit, if you'd like, about some of the myths around affordable housing. The most common one is that it will add school children. So I wanted to highlight that. That is not true, and that's been proven by the likes of MIT and Rutgers. And if there are new school children, that there's plenty of room in the schools, and we know that school budgets are not primarily sensitive to enrollment numbers. So I wanted to open it up to you all, since I have you here, to talk a little bit about what you're seeing, what your largest challenges are from a zoning perspective, and considering all the assets that believe will be tapped for forthcoming, what can we do at the partnership to support you? It was great to hear from Navitak, actually, your mayor, about the TOD project. So I just wanted to open that up as well.
Okay, great. The new project.
Is that okay? Anyone want to have any questions for Katie?
Do you see any apartment sharing, especially for the residents, you know, I guess some of the units are...
Yes, was ever bringing the phone, please
put it on mute while the
yeah.
There's a lot of feedback coming from the calls on the conference phone.
I'll definitely mute my phone.
Thank you. Not that it's you, whoever it is. So people, young people, especially millennials, tend not to be able to even afford $1,200 or $1,500 a month for rent. So they're sharing, right? So they're sharing space. So now you've got two adults living in an apartment, right? So in terms of, I'm just thinking in terms of land use and parking and TODs and all that stuff, you've got two people that require two cars at this point for parking ratio, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you see a lot of that? in your compilation of data?
Yeah, so the rental market is challenging to track for a lot of reasons, and part of it is that it changes so much more frequently than homeownership, but certainly, you know, we are seeing new housing formations. We have seen, you know, three-bedroom, you know, it's right, so in Hartford, for instance, you have all these perfect sixes that was all working fed-class family housing, right? But what we're seeing, and this is nationwide, I was just up at Northeastern last week at their Center for Urban Policy, that those family units have been pushed out by millennials who can't find any other housing options in town because there aren't studio one or two bedroom apartments, and that displaces and puts pressure on units that otherwise would be occupied by families. So it's a whole mismatch, and the pressure in the middle is so great because there just aren't enough options and not enough rungs on the housing ladder. So the pressure is building up, which in part drives up the rental costs. So that's where you're seeing rents, you know, $2,400 for a two-bedroom unit, which is pretty remarkable. I mean, it's no different from parts of Manhattan, Brooklyn, or Boston.
Is that concentrated around higher education centers, however, or there's shit around here?
You see all over. And part of this income and jobs, I laugh a little bit because you know, talking about dental assistants and preschool teachers, and I want to say like, public interest attorneys and social workers, young social workers. So they're migrating to all sorts of job centers, and certainly we've seen that job centers have migrated outside of the city, though now they're coming back to urban centers and a reurbanization. So the need for more housing choices is among not just the urban centers, but also the suburban centers. Certainly locating them near transit, though, reduces the pressure on parking. And that's huge because a parking spot can, you know, mean an additional $50,000 a unit in development costs. So bring down the pressure on parking and the need for a car, that significantly makes that development site more attractive.
You see an increase in the construction of units with one parking?
It's certainly lesser. Hartford just they just released their new zoning regulations and they reduced their parking requirements. They've also created a TOD overlay zone that lowers those parking thresholds.
So it's near transportation.
Mm-hmm.
Any other questions?
How much of the apartments that they're redoing, they're doing so many buildings all real, we over in downtown Hartford, how many of those units are being actually occupied? And do they provide parking? To what extent do they, I mean, is it just one parking space?
I'll have to speak to CRDA about what their parking requirements are. We understand that the absorption has been higher than expected, and they certainly have not all come online. There's going to be hundreds and hundreds of new apartments that are going to be coming online in the Hartford area between West Hartford and Hartford. So it will be interesting to see how that shakes out from a market perspective. But I can get that to you.
And what's happening with the McMansion?
Good question.
I mean, they're all getting older and maybe more McEmpty.
McEmpty.
And where do they go?
And make farther away from transit.
And how many new people are coming in with that kind of income to be want such a large house and a yard? If you're not making much money, you can't afford to live in those places.
Right.
That's your premise.
That's the challenge, and that's the challenge of you all and your zoning commissions to be proactive and say, you know, these aren't selling, what can we do? Do we have enough buyers in the market? Do we not have enough buyers in the market? How can we bring them to the market? Do we have what's being demanded? Do we have one-bedroom studios or small two-bedroom apartments that's affordable and will be close to transit or close to downtown services? It's a challenge. But you need to have buyers to the market so they can buy that senior's home. That's going to downsize. And you know, I think a lot of us can relate to that. I know we bought our home from a couple that lived there for 50 years and had the price reduced several times. There weren't enough buyers in the market. And the unique thing about maintenance implication, as I know personally, buying an older home. But it's a gem as well, because those homes tend to be a little bit smaller. So I was really excited to come down here today, because I think that, you know, you sort of have a lot of the urban fabric and skeleton that a lot of other regions would love to have, right? So in Hartford, we're trying to sell people on bus rapid transit, like as if buses are the antithesis of everything great to the unknown. But and if you haven't ridden Fast Track, I urge you to, because it's a really spectacular amenity now that you have rail, and it sounds like it's really going to be updated, and change is going to happen, and the opportunity for you all, I think, is to stay ahead of it. You know, the housing shouldn't be 3 miles, or the development shouldn't be 3 miles from the train station, but what does it take to develop there? It's probably a brownfield, it's a filthy site, you have the parking burdens, but you know, you tell me, I mean, I think everyone recognizes the assets that are here to be unlocked, but what are the greatest challenges?
If I could ask a question, sure. Just to piggyback on the mansion, has the organization looked into what can these mansions be reused for, or is there a way to look at another use other than a single family for the commission? Has repurposed in another way? Has your organization looked at that question?
So we look at the need to diversify the housing market, and we want towns to be proactive about bringing buyers to town and creating an entryway for young professionals and families to get into town, and we know that that's by way of smaller units that are affordable. So we haven't looked at that because we believe that by bringing buyers to the town, the pressures will be you know, more managed and released. But it's a really interesting question. There's the McMansions. There are, you know, the older mansions in Hartford, and you've probably heard about the Scarborough 11, which is an intentional family in an older stately home, because we have a housing stock that doesn't fit the needs of current families, because they were built to house a staff in addition to families. So it's a really interesting question.
Do you know the reason why for that? Is there something going on in Derby? Are they doing some big development or something or other? Or it's the only one with a positive, but there's school children.
So there are a few like that throughout the state, and these are all based on birth and death rates from the state data center. But there are very, very few and far between. It could be a development, but we also know that schools are closing all over the state because they don't have enough. I was out in the northeast section of the state just last week, and they're thinking about closing middle school. I know of other schools in the Northwest that have 4 kids in their first grade class, so.
I was just wondering if they were doing something right. That's
probably the affordability of housing for young families.
Yeah, probably because Derby was more concentration of apartments.
It looks like they have 57% of housing units have 2 or fewer bedrooms. So, you know, they're able to attract a different kind of demographic. And it's not a competition. I mean, everyone is, you know, what's good, and we heard this last week, right? Like, what's good for Waterbury is good for Beacon Falls, it's good for Missouri, it's good for Naugatuck. So, you are the experts on that side of the world.
Thank you. Anyone else?
You said something about myths about affordable housing. Mm-hmm. Was there anything other than school children?
Oh, there's everything. And
what are
school the children? The myths, affordable housing will bring crime. Affordable housing will reduce property value. Not true. Actually, the former Connecticut Economy, which was UConn's economy publication, actually did a study that towns that have greater mix of housing options, greater diversity of housing options, tend to have higher home values. There's plenty.
So
that's why we publish. I'm sorry. That's why we publish the income and jobs fact sheet. You know, who needs affordable housing? Let's, you know, the dental assistant and the preschool teacher, and you know, not sort of the usual suspects.
I was just going to ask, to define affordable housing.
Yeah, so it's
in a positive light.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, I mean, the face of it is really different. We did a lot of affordable housing poorly in this country, and we continue to live with those stereotypes. The face of it is really different. The push right now is towards mixed income housing, so you have housing development that has a component that is affordable and a component is market rate.
Saybrook and Simsbury and Sharon and Darianne. You know, they're all over the state, and we're happy to talk to your towns more about that.
And how well has the accessory apartment provisions and the affordable housing legislation at the state, 8-30GA, that says you can put 10 years deed restriction on an accessory apartment if you make it affordable,
mm-hmm.
versus other housing is like 30 to 40 years
mm-hmm.
deed restriction. How has that been working? How many towns have actually done that? How many, how many more units have there been? Has that been a very successful option?
Yeah, so the sort of the short answer is like yes to do all that, right? You should allow accessory apartments. You have the infrastructure in terms of towns that have a barn to do that. You should be investing in multifamily housing. I was in Newtown last week presenting to the Economic Development Commission. Actually, someone came up to me right afterwards saying, I have an accessory apartment. I'll deed restrict it if I can get credit for 830G. And for those who aren't familiar with 830G, that is the statute that says if your town does not have 10% of its housing as affordable, a developer could come in and develop. So they wanted to get points for that.
It says a developer can develop regardless of your zoning laws, is what
correct.
It says. And that's the loophole for developers.
Right. So the incentive housing zone program, which is the state's program that I mentioned earlier, is sort of like the into that yang. So it supports towns that want to beat that out, right? And 10% is a really lofty goal. And that's not going to work in every town, but a lot of towns can get to 2%. And if you get to 2% of your housing that's affordable, you have a moratorium from 830 to 4 years. And that's a doable goal, and we can certainly talk more about that.
No, I think the state needs to relook at that law. Because I think it really benefits the developers, not the towns.
Yeah,
I understand where the premise came from, and I agree with it fully, but I think they really need to look at the loopholes that the developers use.
Yeah, certainly, it was developed by the wisdom of the legislature because there wasn't the housing options that are affordable to the workforces that were needed in those towns. And that's where this incentive housing program came from, was, how can we get towns to proactively get to the point of, not having to worry about 830G. So Wilton, for instance, 2 weeks ago just got a moratorium. So they won't have any threat of 830G for the next 4 years. Farmington is just submitting their application. Berlin's got two moratoriums. So it is achievable and it's a realistic goal. It just takes some help planning. But I certainly understand your concerns.
Well, we're also worried about the accessory units, though. If you put, if you're in a single family residential area and that's where you bought your house, all of a sudden everybody starts putting on accessory dwellings and they're making them two family houses. What does that do to the people that have already bought into a single family zone?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and certainly I can share with you some of the research about how does adding affordable housing in your neighborhood affect home prices. And certainly we understand it is the largest check, the largest check I ever wrote was my down payment. And if you're going to threaten that, it's very natural to get tense up about that. And that's where the research really comes in. And where I've seen accessory apartments, and I did an accessory apartment program as a developer in the northwest part of Litchfield County, these were in homes that, frankly, are either already had it or were more secluded. It depends. I mean, I know where I live in West Hartford, where I don't think it's permitted by zoning, I know that it's going on in more places.
Oh, no doubt. There's no doubt. But they're illegal. So,
according to local zoning, but that doesn't fall under G. Does it?
830G? No, it doesn't have to do with that.
No.
No. And it's about finding the right place in New York.
I thought you referenced 830GA.
Well, it has to do, because an accessory apartment can count towards the 830G.
So if accessory apartments are used for, say, senior, you move in your in-laws or in-law apartment, right,
mm-hmm.
where it has to be a family member, that counts toward?
The unit has to be deed restricted.
That means if you wanted to rent it out. If you bought a house and you don't have in-laws or parents that you want to put in that unit, you can deed restrict it for 10 years and the town will get credit towards their affordability, but you need to rent to someone whose income falls within the parameters of affordable incomes.
And that would be a senior center, a senior citizen?
Senior housing counts in some, in, it has to do with a points and calculation system, and senior housing does count towards that.
So, I mean, if you're putting in your in-law, an elderly person.
I can't speak to that. I just know that if you're looking, if you have a unit, and you find that, there's someone, like a school, like a teacher's aide, or a dental assistant, or whatever, and they're looking for housing, you can rent to that person, you get credit, they just have to meet the income, and the town gets credit for having affordable housing, because you do. And also, you can structure the regulation such that you have to have double the acreage. I mean, if you happen to have, it's a one family, it's a 1 acre zone, and if the property has 3 acres, you could convert the garage to have an apartment on the top floor. Or you could take something else that was, and turned into, but if you only have 1 acre, you couldn't do it because you really don't have the density. If you do that, you also have to have a double septic system. You have to have a septic system that accommodates the main house, and then wherever you put the unit, that has to have its own septic system.
So that's within the town's own regulations, correct?
It would still have to follow whatever the town sets as guidelines to having such units.
I'm just curious whether the seniors aren't allowed, if you have an in-law apartment, if that counts for affordable living, if you bring your in-laws in because they can't afford to stay living on their own anymore.
Right, and so I think what we're saying is that it has to be tied to the deed, and then the unit has to remain affordable.
I'm sure there's an answer to my question somewhere.
It's sort of like a yes, right? Are we going to get there by accessory apartments? Are we going to get, is that how we're going to take care of downsizing seniors? Or are we going to be able to build multifamily so we invite young people? It's kind of like a yes to everything. And, the state rewards and incentivizes towns that are planning to do that proactively, figuring out where in the town is the right spot for multifamily housing. What does it look like? From an architectural perspective, the town can have control over that. How many apartments should it be? So the state wants to facilitate those kinds of conversations. So we can talk more about that in the town.
Thank you.
Question. What about the impoverished households?
Mm-hmm.
Where have they been before?
Could you elaborate what you mean by that?
Oh, households living at the poverty level, urban poor, if you will.
So, what I was talking about before with the pressures from this middle market, because there aren't enough rungs on that ladder, the apartment that's occupied right now by 3 college grads is not available for a very low-income family. So where are they going? Right, so the need is to diversify the housing stock. And thank you for pointing it out. This is not just for millennials, it's not just for downsizing seniors. It is to relieve pressures in the housing market that are currently causing families and individuals to be burdened by their housing costs and unable to stay stable because of that. But I don't think that I really answered your question well enough.
Are they leaving? Are they leaving Connecticut because of this?
Some of them are. A lot of them, some people, we hear from folks who are going south, maybe they can afford a house that's half the price.
No, I hear a lot about affordable housing, but I never hear, other than housing facilities, I never hear what's happening with the people who agree with them.
Yeah, there's a really robust nonprofit development industry inside of Connecticut, and the state incentivizes the developments facilitated by those agencies and organizations to allocate housing for those most in need.
Right, but you're not mixing them in.
Oh, yeah,
things.
They are. So in Stonington, there's a development that's going to be market and affordable. And it's going to go all the way from 25% of that area median income, so people who are making very, very low incomes, very, very low incomes, all the way up to market.
So you mean the town of Stonington, or you mean the borough of Stonington?
It's in the town of Stonington.
Okay.
And it's being done by a nonprofit developer.
And they're okay with
survival budget. So we hear from that constituency day in and day out. So the flip side of the Home Connecticut campaign, which is what I'm on, inside of the partnership, is the Reaching Home campaign, the charting solutions to end homelessness. So, you know, it's a yin and yang, right? Like, we can build all the housing units for to like, get people to exit homelessness, but if they're not stable housing or affordable housing, then they're going to fall back into homelessness. So the trick is to develop those apartments that meet those needs, and that's where the state subsidies can play the largest role, because those are the families that are most in need. Right, so what we're seeing with in this incentive housing zone program, which is premised on the idea of we need the density to spread out the cost over more units so that those kinds of projects can be internally subsidized and don't require state subsidy, which I see.
But you're not really about like mixing Section 8 and Section 8.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Oh, mostly, yeah. So the state has, depends on the kind of program. It's a, whether it's a low-income housing tax credit program or a more conventional mixed income project. And the state advances and prioritizes or incentivizes, you know, economic integration. I think most of us would probably reflect that. The programs, the past public programs that have concentrated poverty and ghettoization of that has not been successful. And so the state recognizes that the need for mixing incomes and advancing economic integration is a priority. West Hartford did that. The Housing Authority did that.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Out of curiosity, how much, do you have any idea, what are the rents in the private market in those areas like up Hartford, Bridgeport, Waterbury, New Haven, that you drive through and you look, oh my God, are people really living in these buildings?
Mm-hmm.
How much do people pay for those units?
So,
do you have any idea?
Yeah, I mean, we have the rental data. I'm happy to share that with you. But I think we want to think about, you know, how do we advance those families, you know, out of that, unstable situation into a unit that is, you know, meets the needs of their families and what they can afford.
And you're available for specific questions.
I'm available for it.
Okay.
Much further conversation, and I didn't mean to monopolize your time.
No, that's fine. Thank you so much.
Okay, thanks for having me.
I just wanted to talk about the project that we're starting in the region on the Route 8 Waterbury Branch Line alternative modes study and TOD project that we sort of talked about last week at the Waterbury conference. A couple of years ago, actually, it was the Valley COG received a OPM TOD pilot program grant, and the intent of that was to try to come up with plans for incentivizing TOD development around the train stations on the Waterbury Branch corridor, focusing mostly on the Derby Shelton area and some of the Seymour, because at that time that was the Valley region. We also supplemented that with an FTA grant to look at alternative modes, and so those funds are combined. There's three main tasks of the study. Task one was looking at bike tech connections along Connecticut, Shelton, and Derby, maybe along the Main Street. That study has been completed, and that was done about a year and a half or so ago. Task two is looking at zoning regulations and tools to, again, accommodate TOD types of developments. We're in a draft report right now. What I'd like to do is use the RPC to sort of vet that draft report. What I'm going to do is we're going to email a copy of that report out to all the members. Ask you to take a look at it, offer comments, and at the next full meeting of the RPC, 2 months, mm-hmm. you know, we'd like to sort of, you know, talk about it and do a presentation on it and then get the endorsement of the RPC, and then, you know, that would be the, you know, that would be the final report that we'll present to the COG, for the COG board. And then the third task is, you know, one that we sort of have started. Thank you to Ruth and Nancy, who served on the selection committee, for consulting. We did some consulting interviews this morning. That's a much larger endeavor. We're going to be looking at what improvements or enhancements we can make to the Route 8 Waterbury branch line to really make transit more accommodating, more attractive, more convenient within the, you know, along the Naugatuck Valley. We're going to be looking at, you know, service enhancements on the Waterbury branch. You know, right now, the service is very limited. State has committed to putting signals on the line, putting some passing sightings so that we can allow, you know, trains to pass. That will give us the opportunity to actually enhance service, increase service. Right now, there's 8 inbound trains during the day and 7 coming out from the main line. Headways are 2.5 hours. It's not very attractive to, you know, to try to get commuters to actually use it. So, but with the signal improvements, we're hoping that, you know, we can convince the state to initiate much more frequent service. So that's sort of the thrust of that study, was to look at what kinds of improvements we could make on the Waterbury branch to make that a reality. We're also going to be looking at opportunities for bus rapid transit systems. You know, right now we have fixed route buses to come up from Bridgeport to serve the Lower Valley. We have, you know, transit fixed routes in the greater Waterbury area. They're not really set up to be commuter bus service. So the idea is, can we implement, you know, what's called bus rapid transit from like Derby down to Bridgeport to really provide a, you know, faster connection for people who live up in this area to the main line train stations and, you know, along the Haven line. So that's another option. And we're also going to look at any other, you know, changes to the, you know, transit system within the quarter. So that's going to be a study that we're going to get started real soon on. We had interviews with consultants this morning. We're hoping to select somebody and initiate that study in the next couple of months. Again, what I'd like to do is be able to use the RPC as our sounding board, let's say. You know, we'll do presentations and, you know, have you review the deliverables that the consultant puts together so that we can get your opinions that would then feed into the final report. There will be obviously a significant, substantial public outreach during this study, and, you know, we'll be doing focus groups, community forums, other kinds of outreach to, you know, again, get engage the public in this whole conversation of different types of transportation modes that we, you know, look at. So, again, I just wanted to inform you that that's something that's coming, and to, you know, again, get your assistance on, you know, reviewing and, you know, making comments on.
Is that something you would ask us to bring back to our own commissions?
And we're open to any whatever you'd like to do. Again, the task two one especially, because that's going to be looking at different, you know, zoning regulations or overlay zones, things like that.
Talk about a little bit, 7 hubs and housing.
Well, and
landscape.
Well, again, the idea with the this task two was it can, you know, it's a whole toolkit of different options. Mm-hmm. So any community can, you know, pick and choose. Oh, this might work in our community. You know, some towns don't have transit nodes, so you can't really do transit-oriented development, but you can do sustainable types of development that, you know, may, you know, enhance your town centers and things like that, or provide a niche for redevelopment or, you know, mixed uses and things like that. So it doesn't have to just be, you know, related to a train station, but it can be related to, you know, any kind of a transient of it. For example, you know, Waterbury, Waterbury has a train station, but also has a connection to the CT fast track. You know, that could eventually develop into a more of a transient node. Bristol, same thing. It has a connection to CT fast track. You know, maybe there's an opportunity to sort of merge the two together, you know, have create some kind of a mixed-use development around where the CT fast track buses you know, meet, you know, just as a way of encouraging more people to live in the town center, and then have the transit available to get into Hartford or Burton. But the answer is yes. That's something that we'd like to go and actually meet with the various commissions and, you know, do a presentation to them and you know, offer their solicit their comments and advice. Like I said, we're gonna provide you with that draft report, and then in 2 months, you know, we can do a presentation, and then, you know, continue the dialogue after after that, you know, and go from there.
Okay, any questions of Mark for expansion of his presentation?
Like I said, it's Mark right now, it's just primarily for information, let you know that this is something that's coming. Next full meeting, 2 months, we'll do, you know, sort of a presentation on, you know, some of the ideas that we've come up with.
We'll have a draft before that.
Oh, yes, like I said, we'll send that out. We have a draft that is complete, so we'll, you know, we'll definitely, not tomorrow, we'll definitely by the end of the week, it will be emailed out to everybody. We just got to figure out when we're going to do. It's always a trick, is when we first put things together, we don't think about how big these reports and documents can grow. So we'll have to make sure that we compress it so that it's we can, you know, send it without blowing up anybody's ability to receive.
Okay, thank you. I've given some to Sean earlier. I did get some from Nancy Nancy Hart earlier. Mm-hmm. And you want to go through those sort of questions?
Sure, okay. For some discussion.
Okay. First off, on the first page where it says officers, in the definitions, letter H, that should be the chairperson, vice chairperson, and secretary of the commission. Those are the officers.
Do you want a motion to accept this on the second discussion?
Well, we can go to make more amendments. You can make the amendments first and then have a motion to accept as amended.
And then we've got on page 2, where it says meetings, letter C. And we're talking about the executive committee may act on matters which they have been given authority to act by the commission or the council, and on all other matters on which the commission may act, as long as all commission members are notified pursuant to these operating procedures and have no objections, and a majority of the executive committee is in attendance. So instead of every member, you would have a majority, which would be 3 people.
Joanna, does this mean that everyone has no executive committee? If one person has an objection to the executive committee taking action, they can't. Should that be perhaps a little
flushed out a bit?
Yeah, you might want to have more of a minimum number of people.
Minimum number of what people?
Well, it's going where all commission members are notified pursuant and have no objections. And the question is, does that give every single commission member veto power over the executive committee's authority?
I don't think it's veto power.
Well, they can't. Yeah.
If somebody has an objection, they can't.
If one person has an objection, they get that could be an instruction. So I think that it should probably be more than one person.
Yeah.
I'm not suggesting a number, but. So, no, just so
let me come back to the
RPC commission, if there were an objection. So the executive committee would not take action. It would have to be a
right.
commission.
Right. Right. I guess by the quorum. I'm thinking, my suggestion is that there more than one objection should be, but you know, objection of a minimum number of members.
So you're talking about more of a consensus instead of...
Or a majority.
Or
a majority, or at least a minimum number. Could it be less than a majority if you have to have like four members object before their action is blocked, as opposed to just one?
Yeah, I think that makes sense. I think it makes sense to put a minimum number in there.
I have a suggestion.
Is that Mike? Was that you, Mike?
That was Mike from Eagle Falls.
Okay, thank you.
Three or more?
Is that referring to member of alternate or town?
That would be the actual representatives. Each there's one vote per member.
Right.
Right. So it would be the representative, or if that representative is not present, then the alternate. But it couldn't be both representative and alternate. It has to be one vote, one town, one representative.
So really, bottom line, it's the town. It would be an objection by town, not by an individual, whether that be an alternate or a member.
Correct.
I see it as it's going to be an interest for that town or municipality anyway. You're not going to get two or three people to object because it's specific to, usually specific to a member town.
But when you get three or four towns.
Yeah, that's, yes, right. That may be counterproductive.
It just makes sense to have a majority, to be a majority, and then if there's an issue, it goes back to the full RPC or staff for tweaking or whatever.
I just got a little confused when you said the town. I mean, the objections would come from this body, a member of this body, or it would have to be an objection from a member of the council.
Well, that's where it originates.
So can I come for something? I just really...
Yes, Marie. Yes.
Remember,
go ahead, Marie.
If I remember our conversation, that we were willing to go with even one objection because we don't always know what's going on in the town. Mm-hmm. And with that, it would mean that we have to bring it to the full body for further discussion and review.
That was when we were discussing the appeal process, yes.
Yeah.
Again.
A member is defined on the first page of the municipality.
Yes, it is.
Well, in item C, it says may act as long as all commission members.
That's RPC.
Right, are notified and have no objections. To me, that reads as long as commission members have no objections.
Right.
Okay, so we're not talking about members of the council.
No. Okay. Small M is a commission, RPC okay. commission. Large end is the member town.
Okay.
From the council.
In the absence of the member, and the alternate would be able to vote or object, and it seems to me the wording would eliminate that person from participating if the full member were not available.
I believe it wouldn't because of the way the structure of the representative, what their duties are, and what the duties of the alternate, and that's outlined in the previous section, I believe,
yes.
Where it says representation. So it's quite clear in there about when the alternate, what the alternate does, and that the alternate will not
that the alternate, in your case, the point that you're making, that the alternate will have voting privileges in the absence of the representative.
Correct.
Right. So I just want to make sure that it's clear that in essence the alternate becomes a member for purposes of this section.
Well, we have that for all.
So,
if they're seated for the regular, yes. They're seated for the regular member.
Yes.
Right.
We have that for all operating procedures. There's nothing excluded. And I think that needs to be reinforced. So the way I'm reading this, though, is that the executive committee, we're talking about the executive committee making decisions, right? So the executive committee may act on matters which they've been given authority to act by the commission.
Yes.
So the things you can vote on, that you know that you can vote on,
Yes.
And on all matters on which the commission may act. So there's certain things that the commission needs to act on as a whole.
Yes.
So that's okay. And in that case, the commission needs to be notified, and if someone objects,
even one person.
Correct. Yes.
So are we having one person, or are we having, you talked about earlier about a minimum.
Well, let's take a consensus. I think it's good as it stands, so that one person may make an objection. They don't need to collaborate with other municipalities, because it's usually a local issue where there's an objection, probably 100% of the time.
We're talking about executive committee only? Okay. We're talking about allowing the executive committee act for the commission as a whole.
Yeah, but if one person objects, it goes back. It goes to the full for RPC board.
That's the way it's written.
Okay. Just want to make sure I understand it, right?
I think it should be more than one. It's not a bad idea to get the towns having to support each other.
Has it ever happened? In history, exactly. It's rare, but one town ought to be able to, one municipality ought to be able to object, because it's an issue that relates to their.
And then it would kick it back and start all over again, and people could settle out from there. So one town, I could let it stand.
I agree.
Yeah, I would agree too.
Well, say it's something controversial and somebody objects on the executive board. When it comes back to the full RPC, we're only looking at a majority. If it's something controversial, that we have to take a vote on something.
Well, the person to object will most likely be the person that's involved in what's being voted on, right? So rather than having just a three-person decision, that person should have the right to bring it back before the full commission. If I'm understanding this correctly.
And most matters are decided by the full commission.
Right, yeah.
So it's just more of a safeguard, right? For everyone.
So I think we have a consensus, do we? To leave it as is.
As is.
Okay. Do you have something else to say, John? The last page I
need. Okay, so on page 3, that we're talking about page E, meeting actions. The last part of that sentence, a special work group shall be decided by a simple majority of all representatives present, constituting a quorum and voting.
Yes, a quorum.
Right. On page 5, Nancy was looking at reports and plans. B, or I think that should probably be A.
Right.
Should be A. Okay.
I'll start out the items.
All reports and plans which are published by the commission, including any reports and minutes of the meetings, shall be filed with the chief elected official and municipal clerk of each member. If I'm understanding Nancy's concern, she wants to know who's responsible for filing those reports and plans, there's no specific person identified. When I was speaking with you earlier, I was saying that right above it, use of council staff, that directs, the commission directs the staff to work on behalf of the commission. So, or the council can do that as well. So,
if we do that, that's, we don't have to do it for each.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
Each filing, I think it needs to be clear that the members are not responsible for filing that with the chief elected official. It is staff that is responsible, so that...
Right, and I just want to just make sure I'm understanding correctly. All throughout this document, there are things that either the secretary needs to do, yes, or other, where they say the commission shall do this. All of those specific actions can be delegated to the NBCOG staff. Mm-hmm. So, but in this particular case, you feel it needs reinforcement. I just want to make sure.
I do, so if there's any lapse.
Okay.
Members aren't.
Okay. How is, are there any other opinions on this?
Anything else?
Yeah, that's all I had from our conversation earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Want to make a motion accept this?
Accept as amended?
Yeah.
Second. Okay. And a second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Abstentions? Okay, thank you. We have a wonderful procedures in place. Yay. Okay. This word is subcommittee formation we've talked about now for a few months. We had a representative from the Pomp Rock River Watershed Coalition under Jean made a presentation to all of us about regionalization of water sources, sharing, quality, quantity, and we're looking to see if there were any kind of a regional plan for interconnection between our communities instead of focusing on our municipalities individually to see what their plans were for future interconnection. And we suggested we form a subcommittee, perhaps with someone from Pomp Rock River Watershed Coalition, someone maybe from Waters Alliance, from this, certainly this body, and any other suggestions? Those are the three that I would look to. I think we need to have some.
Would you want outreach to any of the actual providers?
I think that the government side.
Yeah, because Thomaston uses Connecticut Water. And they usually have outreach staff, they may be interested. I don't know if they might go in that direction.
That's the same thing with Clarion.
Mm-hmm. I think their input is absolutely essential. And some of those decisions probably are in place. Maybe that's something we need to preliminarily look at to see what exists and what discussions they've had and what agreements they have and what draft agreements they have. I think as a regional commission, we need information. And I think we can also offer input. And it seems to be, since we are regionalizing these resources, I think we've got great value.
If I may add.
Yes, of course.
This came out of the executive committee meeting, just to give you a few of the goals of this water use subcommittee that they were talking about. again, like the chairperson Clark was talking about, raise awareness of water issues with the chief elected officials, first and foremost. Understand the state plans on these water usage. Disseminate the knowledge to use in local and regional water conservation issues. And the ultimate goal was to create recommendations to include in the and become regional plan of conservation and development.
Yes.
That would probably have the most visible statement on what, on pursuing this awareness and actual implementation of water usage. Ordinances, apologies.
Ultimate goal is, yes, part of it.
Yeah.
Part of the plan.
It all depends on how detailed you want to get. If you're going to start getting all the water companies involved, you're going to start getting down to real small, like what Oakville Fire District, Watertown Fire District, you know, or you're just going to kind of keep it, you know, more on a regional basis, being the Army Corps of Engineer and the health districts. But you can really make this into a real big subgroup, or you can kind of keep it small. I don't know which way you want to go with this.
It might be nice if we're talking about a regional plan and have some input from the water, you know, water companies, at least to some extent, even if it's kind of general input.
I've been to some of their meetings, and they definitely have discussions about need, development, where the future source and...
And you can see their concerns as companies themselves,
yes,
too.
Yeah. Maybe we should first have a forum with the water companies and query them on what their plans are for the future, for this region.
So this is actually focusing on like drinking water supply, how water is used, how it's conserved, not the broader sense of stormwater. You know, well, I didn't even think of stormwater. I was thinking more of like use of the rivers and the watersheds.
I think we're not going there.
We're talking about basically utility.
Yeah.
Okay.
Drinking water. Water that people would need for drinking or running a car wash or whatever.
Well, there are also residential, commercial, and industrial needs.
Right.
All three. Not just drinking water.
Yeah. So try and find out what they're like. Are you looking for data from them to see what it is they're projecting out? Especially if we tend to go toward these TODs,
yes,
this high density.
Mm-hmm.
Can they supply it? Are they, you know, equipped? Do they need new, more infrastructure? Is that what you're looking to compile?
Yeah, and I'm sure they have.
Yeah, I think they could be helpful.
Also.
Yeah.
Sure. You know, so see where they are. So maybe we should first have some kind of a forum sponsored by this body for information sharing. Okay. We all are interdependent.
It would be something, so you're not talking about a guest speaker to hear, not having it as an agenda item, but having it as its own separate,
yes,
event.
Yeah. That's just an idea, and that's maybe to put on the table. It just, we know, for instance, that Southbury serves Middlebury, serves Oxford, serves Southbury, and every other municipality has the same kind of a... Okay. So interdependence.
I was going to say, who besides can get water in Aquarian do we have for water utilities?
You know, library.
Oh, they have, you know,
how many municipal water companies?
Yeah, I was thinking more about multi-town water companies, but yeah.
That's something we need to take a look at. Make sure it's inclusive.
Okay. Bob, did you have a comment?
I just said water town, you know, where I'm... We border on the Watertown Fire District, so that's an entity, for example, that determines for Woodbury where the aquifer protection areas are.
That's down the road, I think. First, to get information from the water companies is what we're talking about as our first.
Well, my understanding was that was Watertown was considered a water company.
quasi-public agency.
Is it?
Yeah, and then they also have the fire district too, which is a water supply, but they're getting there some water. So you're gonna get quite a tangled web into that, let me tell you. Mm-hmm. It's gonna be.
If you have a fire district, where does the fire district get its water?
They're getting it from Waterbury.
They're getting it from the city of Waterbury's water department?
Yes.
That's where we're starting.
Water department.
Now you're gonna get into Torrington. You know, you're gonna get quite a few outfits in that. You need a big office place for that. But it's a start. You gotta start somewhere.
Yes. Yeah. Get the basics first from the water companies existing in our region.
Okay, I will see you. Hello? Yes?
I think you have to look at it. It was something like this body is looking at it. Water is not local. It's regional. And it's interregional. So we've got to get as big a net as possible so that there's nothing left out of the picture.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Thank you.
So are you directing staff to start going in and
first tell us what companies are involved in our region, what our goal is for this forum, information we're going to request, some kind of mapping, where is the potable water, where are the water sources, what is the plan in existence.
Okay.
Thank you. Director of approval is not that 26 is the December 1st meeting minutes. Everyone has. If we review it already, we can take a motion.
I just have one minor correction on my comment. I just want to clarify the Nato building, the Nato block. N-A-T-T-O. It's just a spelling. I did not spell it for you.
That's under Shelton.
You're correct.
One more time.
N-A-T-T-O.
Thank you.
Anything else?
I'll make a motion to approve. I just want to, before we go forward, we did get some amendments before the meeting from Gil Bradline, Cheshire should be Gilbert Lindner, not Gil Bradline. And
you can take a second, so we're still discussing amendments.
Okay. And on page 3, where there's references to the board, it should be Endicott Council. You've got Meadow or Shelton. And as far as Southbury, for Nancy Clark, the third sentence, restaurant and possibly multi-use performing arts area and residential apartments. And the last sentence, the two brownfield sites, one is Southbury Training School and the second is a former landfill. So we've got those corrections. Anybody else?
Entertain a motion.
Okay. I'll motion to accept as amended.
Do you have a second?
Second.
Okay, any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Opposed?
Aye.
Abstentions?
Abstain.
We have 3 abstentions.
Yeah, it wasn't here.
So that's Sue, Jeffrey,
Luxury Glasses, thank you. Correspondence?
As you result, maybe not everyone knows, there was the Envision Conference this past January 28th, this past Thursday at the Palace Theater. 165 people attended. We actually got more people registered, but counting those people who did not attend, we had a 73% participation rate from those who had actually registered for the conference. And we've already gotten a lot of positive feedback from the attendees.
So.
Job well done.
Well done. Very informative.
You were there right there. Yes. I know you were there.
It was a great conference.
So. I was more than I heard great things about it.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. The location, the lunch while they talked.
Yes, very well done.
Great. The NDCOG staff has been increased. We've got new hires, Karen Spetz. She's a part-time engineer. She's reviewing site plans that have to do with road and transportation planning. And Ben Mueller, he's the new transportation planner. We do have one person who has moved on, and that's Sean Kelleher. He attended the last full RPC meeting. He has accepted a job in the District of Columbia, so he's actually there right now. So you're going to miss him very much. So. As far as referrals that I've received in January, I've only gotten three. However, I'm working on one for Thompson that was received in December. But the ones in January, I don't see as being regionally significant. So just so you know.
What's the status of the office donation?
We have got actual, well, you saw, I don't know, for the last RPC meeting, if the imaginary walls were up.
No.
Okay. So we had the studs up, not actually filled in the walls. And, yeah, we've got the conference room going. It's all still needing to be built. But, yeah, that's one of the reasons we have it here today. It's much more pleasant and much more accommodating. But, yeah, it's in the process of being built. We're hoping in the next month that we'll at least have a conference room for meetings. So.
What's the timeline for completion?
Oh. Ask different people different answers, but we're hoping by the fall.
Okay.
So we're hoping it'd be a lot sooner than that. But there has been construction actually done in the last month, which is hopeful.
Are they working just off out? They were there today working, no? Do they work during the day while you folks are driving?
They do. Okay. They do. So I couldn't give you the details. I can send it in an email with that particular decision. But we do have this space, and we're trying to keep it still central to NBCOG, the offices here when we have our meetings. But this cast over room is being used quite often by NBCOG right now.
Next item on our agenda is a summary of the executive committee meeting. We've covered everything that was discussed at the executive committee meeting already. Unless you have anything additional.
So I'll just do a short summary. We talked again about the operating policy. There was an announcement about the Northeast Corridor, that's the different transit options that are being considered by the federal the Railroad Administration, FRA. And just so you, if anyone wants to do a public comment, there's a public comment period going on right now, and it has been extended from the end of January to February 15th. So if you go on the NEC Futures website, you can still make a comment on there. We talked about guest speaker suggestions. On the list is Randall Arendt. He does conservation design for subdivisions. We were also very interested in PA 490 lands, meaning perhaps getting Joan Nichols from the Connecticut Farm Bureau Association to speak at one of our RPC meetings. Also, also Howard Rifkin, who is now legal counsel to the new mayor of Hartford, Mayor Bronin. And he used to be the director of the Partnership for Strong Communities, which is what that's Katie Schaefer was representing today. And finally, how does an assessor go about assessing a property? So we were hoping to have a couple guest assessors come, one from a county like Litchfield, one of the towns from Litchfield County, and maybe one from a more typically farm eastern Connecticut like Woodstock, coming and discussing how you do the assessments. So that's part of that. I want to announce, I know I handed it out, but for the people on the phone, we do have a planning commissioner basic training class set up. And that's going to be happening through the UConn Clear Land Use Academy. And it's going to be happening on March 5th at the Watertown Fire Department. It's going to be a half day on a Saturday from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And it's going to be covering legal requirements, procedures, roles and responsibilities, and also the fundamentals of reading site plans. And again, this is open to the NVCOG planning commissioners and whoever else is in the planning field for NVCOG is working for that. I wanted to open it up, have a week to open it up for the NVCOG towns and then open it up to the general public. But it's going to, Bruce Hyde is going to be teaching that class. He is the Land Use Academy director and he's done this many times before. So we're looking forward to it. It's free, absolutely free of cost. So we're hoping a lot of people will show up. There's going to be cookies and refreshments as well. And there's free parking behind the firehouse. So.
I've been before, I know that you said you'd see me before, I don't know if anyone else has.
So please come for a refresher. Don't feel like, just because it's basic. Mm-hmm. Everyone needs a little, a chance to ask questions of your side, if you have any particular questions.
Is that open to all members of our commissions?
Yes.
Okay.
I at least try to get our new members to go, during their first year to one of these.
We have quite a few members on ours.
So
yeah.
Right.
Posted at your town hall, please, probably better send an email. I will send an email tomorrow with this
PDF
attached.
Okay.
Right. Will another session be held this year with that, or is that just a once a year event?
That is usually from what I understand, the CoGCNV used to have this every 2 years. If this is something that you guys want to do on an annual basis instead, we can open it up and find out what UConn Clear, maybe there's a second class that's...
They also offer them periodically at their extension and had them too.
We wanted this to be more accessible to any kind of towns here.
But in case somebody has to miss it. Mm-hmm.
Right.
So we can look at next January's agenda.
Yes.
Okay.
So that's all I had for...
Thank you so much. And the executive committee notes.
I'm sorry?
And the executive committee.
Yes, that's also.
Okay. So we'll go around the table now. Please give your name and your town, especially if you're on the phone. What's going on? Would you like to start with?
Sure. Ruth Markins, Shelton, County Zoning. Our downtown continues to be revived. We just received one meeting ago for an old factory to be turned into apartments along with mixed use. So there's a separate building being built on the property as well as the reuse of an existing building. Seeing a lot of interest still on Bridgeport Avenue as well. A lot of interest in residential. So keep our eyes open for that and we actually are in hope. We have a public hearing right now, so I really can't discuss that, as you know, when we have a public hearing open. But it is to redo our zoning for the downtown core business district, our CBD. Just a few minor tweaks on it. Nothing really substantial, just trying to make it more cohesive and make it more attractive for private development.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Gary Giordano with the town of Bethlehem. Things are very quiet with the commission. We had one of our shortest meetings last month. And I know there are some public improvements will be coming to us shortly from talking with the first selectman between some parking lot rebuilding and road projects and drainage. So hopefully we'll be a little busier next month with our commission.
Thank you.
I'm Mark Islan. I'm with the town of Plymouth. And we passed a moratorium on gun ranges. We had 4 or 3 months of controversy by 3 TV stations coming to the town hall, and they passed a moratorium for 6 months, and now we have to actually start doing something to figure out what to do. But we won't be accepting any applications. We had a gun range which was, I would call, basically was, I would call, industrial in its character. The regulations allow for these kind of clubs, but didn't really have very much teeth or specifics in terms of standard other than no harm to the neighborhood. but then we had a petition to outlaw it totally, make it a prohibited use. That got denied without prejudice, and then we passed a moratorium to figure out what to do. And now we have 5 more months to figure out what to do.
If you like, I could start. We went through that about 4 or 5 years ago.
Oh, okay. And
that's a lot of research.
Yes, and we first thing we found is nobody really regulates these things. Everybody has guidelines, but nobody regulates them except for zoning. And what it boiled down to is pretty much getting an engineer to design it and put a seal on it, because the bullets can go so far, literally half a water grade would have to be kept depopulated while the thing is in use, except they would have mountains in the way. But I can send you the regulations.
That'd be very good. Now, we found out that there was, you called the state police department, and you would get, like, the question was, does anybody review gun ranges in your office? And you get the answer like, I don't know. You mean the police department, the state police don't review gun ranges? No. Let's find out if anyone does. Does anybody? No, there are no laws. Oh, but you know, obviously, yes, you have to have a gun permit to operate a gun. At the gun range, you actually have to have a permit to own the gun. So there is regulation of the people who will be members, are regulated by the feds and the state in terms of having a gun permit. But the actual operation of the facility, there is no one who reviews it or makes sure that they have designed it properly, or they have, you know, inspects it or anything.
Well, where does the regulation come that you cannot fire on private property from 500 feet of your property line? Is that a local regulation?
I think that's a hunting regulation. Yeah. That's a hunting regulation.
That's correct.
But this wasn't hunting. This is a gun range.
Yeah.
Didn't you go through this in the 80s at the Hancock Dam?
I did do that, something like that. Yes, but that was,
come back again.
That was a big while ago. I wasn't there yet. Right. Didn't even know about it yet.
It
was a private club. But I mean, the difference is between, I would say, there's a difference between the racket club, which is, you know, that there are some people just go and play racquetball or tennis or whatever, versus a club as in
fishing game.
No, I mean more a club as in LA Fitness. LA Fitness is one level of club where you have to be a member, but it's a commercial enterprise. It is, you fill out your application, they say sure, you meet the requirements, pay us the fee, and you can be a member. Versus a club which is more a social activity where they figure out it's more of a non-profit in nature, it's much more casual, it's not as intense, versus we had a situation where what was coming in was to be quite intense. It was like 36 spaces to shoot a rifle at any given length. And, you know, yes, you had bullets that could go for miles, and it wasn't just the bullets flying and what size of bullets they were involving, but it was also the noise it creates. And how can it be muffled, or how is it muffled?
Would OSHA not be involved in
something? Yeah. Well, OSHA, I found the two main focuses of regulation for outdoor ranges was actually EPA and lead, the lead mitigation lamps. And for indoor ranges, it was OSHA with air quality, indoor air quality.
But DEEP does not regulate the establishment of the gun range. It regulates the gun range once the lead is already in the dirt.
Correct.
Once you fill it with lead, now we have a situation where we have a hazardous site because it's full of lead. But there's no one at DEEP that says you can't fill it with lead. Because there is no law about that.
What do they do with the spent casings?
Well, that's, you know, what do you, that's a good question because...
It's not regulated.
Well, the spent, once it's in the thing, that becomes, now you have a situation where...
A disposal of that, right?
Yes, but it also, it can, what might happen is, what does that mean if there's the groundwater round table?
Did you do any research so you don't have to reinvent the wheel where this has been regulated elsewhere?
Well, that's what we have to figure out in the next 5 months.
I did a couple of years ago, and...
In what area? In Connecticut or...
Well, you sort of go nationwide pretty quick with it because there's not a lot of regulations out. You have guidelines from the Department of Defense, guidelines from the Department of Energy, and guidelines from the National Rifle Association, all of which are guidelines. None of them are,
not regulations. And not enforceable.
Again, in my search, one of the things that I found that actual regulation of a gun range as a land use pretty much falls into the province of zoning.
Yeah.
Except in that one.
And you're going to share that.
Except in that one.
And then there's noise.
Yeah.
And then once
you have a situation, it's not there anymore.
Go ahead, Bob.
RNG has allowed hunting and target shooting on their property.
She said it was okay.
Kudos. Okay. Thank you.
Jeremy Lefford, the land use administrator in Thomaston. I guess to save on publication costs and keep our planning and zoning commission busy, I threw a whole slew of amendments at them all at once, which is opening actually tomorrow night. We're taking on a rewrite of our agricultural regulations, pretty much not a wholesale rewrite, but we're probably correcting or adding or subtracting about half the agricultural regulations. We're taking on pallet and marijuana producers and distributors regulations, revamping our whole non-conforming uses section in our zoning regs, and correcting some language and some regulations for rear lots and lot access all at the same time. We have five different regulations and the public hearings opening tomorrow. So that'll keep us busy for probably the next 4 to 6 months, I would guess, on that commission. Some other things going on. We have we're one of our major manufacturers in the southern part of town is looking into the potential of extending the sewer line. The external sewer line main is already from Waterbury is already extending through Watertown and up to the new garage, the new bus depot, state bus repair depot there, and. One of the manufacturers up a little north of there is looking to possibly extend that sewer line to their operations, and the town is sort of aiding where we can in trying to get some steep money for some assessments of the street and how far we need to take it and what we're looking at underneath the road, as far as some cost analysis and things like that. So that's sort of in the works. In the fall, we throughout 2015, but in the fall, we accepted or we passed amendments to our liquor regulations and our adult use regulations. Those adult regulations we split into some part of it is in zoning regulations and part of it is an ordinance that's enforced under our police department. Later this week on Thursday, we have the town meeting on accepting that ordinance so we can make all these regulations effective on our liquor and adult-oriented business uses. The only other thing I have is our Greenway committee is waiting on some grant money to work on our Greenway committee, but it's really a collaborative between Watertown and Thomaston on their section of the proposed Greenway. So we're waiting here on state funding for that. That's what I have for major items right now.
Thank you. Sue Gagan, Alvaro Wagtuck. I'm the town planner and zoning enforcement officer. I'm a law enforcement officer. I wasn't exactly sure what to bring for you since it's my first meeting, but there's a lot going on in Naugatuck right now. We're working on redevelopment of the downtown area. I know there's talks with the state on moving the train station from one location to the other. We have a prime location for housing downtown, and it's just there's a lot of great ideas going on being thrown out there now. We're working on creating a new zone on Prospect Street, Route 68, sort of a mixed use zone, which was something that was called for in the plan 2013 Planning, Conservation, and Development. A little bit of resistance from some of the residents. I don't know if you guys have ever been through comprehensive, zone change of the street, but yeah, the residents are like, we don't want it. So we'll see how that goes. We just recently revised our zoning regulations to allow for outdoor seasonal sidewalk dining. Our alcohol regs. We did kind of the same thing, I think, what you did, because our ordinances didn't allow for alcohol consumption on sidewalks, and some of our downtown restaurants are saying, well, we want to put tables out here, and so we revised our regulations. The borough ordinance was revised, and that still has yet to be approved, maybe tonight, and so that's a great thing. The downtown business owners are very excited to have people being able to sit outside and
time, you know, during the summer, and just, I mean, it's great. It's great. And I went, actually, we used a lot of Torrington's regulations, and they were really helpful.
I borrowed from them, too.
Did you? Okay, they were really good. We just had a zone change to allow a restaurant to go in our former train station, which our historical society used to be in, and they just moved out. So that's an exciting thing. They're going to have an outdoor patio, and, you know, hopefully it won't be too loud with the train going by, but it sounds like it's a great plan. We'll see.
Well, they'll go by that often, so you don't do that.
Yeah, well, that's true. They increase the traffic. I don't know. We'll see, right?
Comes a problem, means there's more trains.
That's a good thing, right? Right. Yeah, then we'll have all that foot traffic, and it'll be great. We have a new plan for this building that was just recently approved. The building is just about complete. They're going to be looking for a CO the middle of this month. That's, you know, a really good thing. So, where we actually have some things going on. I mean, it's not a ton, but it's development.
Good. Okay, the staff area is extremely quiet. Anyone asks about the theater, and they are proposing to weather permitting now for the foundation. And projected opening is in the fall still. It's coming along. We have our agenda this week. It's a lot like revision. It's really slow.
Wow.
It's okay. Thank you. Okay.
Keep on the phone.
Yes, keep on the phone. Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, Bob? Hello?
Not much going on in Woodbury at this time. We have the our annual Land Use Commission meeting 2 weeks ago. We are still waiting to hear from the AIA group that came in and visited us and gave us a picture or asked us for of what we wanted to do with Woodbury. So we came up with an idea of Imagine Woodbury, and they're supposed to be coming back quite shortly with their recommendations. Other than that, we are still going through land use regulation changes. That's it from us.
Okay, thank you. Marie?
And in Bristol, we have three major things that are in the flow. We have, we approved a site plan in our industrial park for POTS, and their building is supposed to be as large as a Walmart store, so that's pretty huge from the standpoint of logistics. The downtown revitalization, we actually have Bristol Hospital has proposed to put a medical office on that property, so that'll jumpstart some of that activity because that's a little bit slow. And short-term memory. The Route 6 corridor. Our money's a little clear, so we're out there getting, I guess they're called RPI, or, response to engagement. Let's see what people will produce.
Okay, is that it? Yes?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, bye.
Okay, I think Jim is the last person.
Mike,
I'm sorry. Mm-hmm.
So if we can follow, we recently had the Connecticut Siting Council come into town to review and evaluate the Beacon Falls Energy Plan. They did so, and they approved the plans that the Beacon Falls Energy Park put forward. So I believe that's moving forward, and they have all the information from their reviews available online, I believe, now for anyone to take a look at. In addition to that, we've had quite a bit of work going on around town on our various roads, doing road improvements. improvement, repaving of our town hall parking lot, things of that nature. That's been coming along pretty nicely. But we do also have one kind of a standout issue in town. We have a private road that's, I don't know all the details behind it. I'm still getting caught up on it myself, but I believe they ended up going to court with the town a little bit because the road is sort of used as a through road for, you know, the community is using it, community at large is using it, and the residents on that road believe that because it's being used as a through road, they should get some additional support slash compensation from the town in terms of garbage pickup and things of that nature. Along the road instead of at the end of it, I believe the court ruled in their favor for right now. I think it's up.
You're talking about the state flyover,
right,
and all that. I know that Glenda Prentice is working on, she's our GIS person,
okay.
She's working on that issue. I think it was tied with an ARPIP grant, so...
Make sure I can give her a call then?
You can give her a call. I can pass on the information
sure.
that you'll be calling her.
Okay.
She was actually talking about that today, and I think it's part of a grant that she's waiting to hear from.
And I do have one other thing to talk to her about. The GIS page, somehow or another, at our meeting was not showing the aerial photography on it, so... Because we usually bring it up, if some of the commissioners of the town will say, where is that? And we take our laptop out and show them, and it wasn't showing the satellite imagery on it, so...
Okay. I will tell her that
okay.
to call you.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. Motion to adjourn. So moved.
Second.
Aye.